And I've seen him giving some talks over here as well.
I think today morning he had some workshop or something.
You have the scars? You can give to people who are asking good questions. Yeah, I should have seen the lace.
This I got it from Amy. Today I'm going to talk about Overton cluster hyperconvergence. So how many of you know Overt? That's good. How many of you use Overt? Great. And with cluster? Overt with cluster? Cool. This might be interesting for you now. This is going to be my agenda for next 40 minutes. First I will introduce you to Overt. Maybe most of you since know. I will just roughly talk about the architecture and storage. Then I will talk to you about hosted engine. Then I will introduce you to cluster and basic components in the cluster. Then we will see how to set up a hyperconverged infrastructure using Overton cluster. How it looks and how to set up and how do you manage the setup. Then I will talk a little bit about the recent enhancements we did for hyperconvergence case in Overt as well as cluster. Let's get started. So basically Overt is a virtualization management platform which helps you to manage your virtual machines, also for storage, also storage and networks for the virtual machines. Yes, if you see from the diagram on top, we have an Overt engine that runs in a separate hardware and inside a JBoss application server. That the Overt engine is written in JBoss, written in J2E, and runs in a JBoss application server that takes care of managing your hypervisors and storage. Overt engine uses PostgreSQL as a DB, and that exposes main two interfaces for the user to communicate. One is the web admin portal where you can define your cluster, you can add your hypervisors, you can add your storage nodes, and you can create your virtual machines there. Also, it exposes nice REST APIs which can be used to integrate Overt with other management platforms like ManageIQ or CloudForms, etc. Below Overt, you see the clusters. It's like a cluster of hosts. Those are all virtualization enabled. Mostly we use KVM virtualization. That takes care of running the virtual machines in the host. Overt uses something called VDSM. It's an agent or daemon running in all the hypervisor, and it's written using Python. That takes care of all the hard pulling for Overt. Overt communicate to host through VDSM. It asks VDSM to like create a virtual machine or stop the virtual machine or start a VM, attach disk. All those hard steps are done by the VDSM. Just the engine manages the host. And underneath you see storage. So traditionally Overt supports different storages like NFS or FCP or iSCSI and ClusterFS as well. That can be managed by cluster or managed by Overt, or it can be independent of Overt like iSCSI or FCP or NFS. Next we will see specific about storage architecture. So storage is the main component in Overt, because the VDSM completely relies on the storage to store the virtual machine images and as well as the config files and other things. Also it relies on the storage for synchronization between the VMs. Like the same VM should not be running on multiple hypervisors. Also the locking and synchronization is handled by SAN lock, and that's done through storage domain, which is this actual storage here. And Overt supports these storages like NFS, FCP, iSCSI. There is one difference between other storages and ClusterFS, because NFS and other FCP storages are single point access where you have to communicate to a host to get your storage. But ClusterFS is different because it's a clustered file system. And it has multiple hosts. So if one host fails, VDSM or Overt can talk to other hosts to get the VM images or other data. That's why ClusterFS is more useful. Next, the hosted engine. If you see in the previous slide, Overt engine runs in a separate hardware. And that's again what if that machine fails? That's a failure point. Also, you have to dedicate one hardware for the VM, for the Overt engine. Instead, you can use something called hosted engine, where the Overt engine itself will run in a VM. And that VM will run in any of those hypervisor hosts. You can get rid of one host, one physical host. Also, you get catch. If one host fails, the Overt engine can run on another host. You get catch for Overt engine as well. So in this hosted engine setup, there is something called hosted engine Ache agent, which will be running on all the hypervisors, so that if one host fails, the other host will automatically start the hosted engine on it, and that can manage all other hosts. So in the end, the Overt engine will be always running and you can always manage your hosts. But it's kind of chicken egg problem, because since you have a VM which manages itself and the other hosts which are running the VM. So what you need is you have to do bootstrap deployment to bring up that VM, then add the other hosts. Maybe I will talk about this later with more information or exact steps, how do you do it. Okay. That is about hosted engine. Next is ClusterFS. As you all know, ClusterFS is an open source distributed file system. It runs on any commodity hardware, and it can scale up to petabytes easily. As you see in the diagram, it can be accessed through multiple protocols like ClusterFS or NFS, any SIFS or lately Lipjack API. What it does is basically aggregates different storage exports, like different storage exports from different hosts, and give it in a single namespace, which is more reliable and replicated or distributed. There are multiple things. Maybe next slide I will talk about the basic thing. So brick is a basic component in OVERT, in cluster. It's the actual place where your data is getting stored. It's actually a mount point. You see from this diagram, you have a block device in the system, and you format it, you get a file system on it, and you mount it on your system, and that mount point becomes your brick. Brick is a place where your actual data is getting stored, and the limitation on the brick is completely on the system. There is no limitation from the cluster side. Whatever the brick can hold, the amount of data the brick can hold is completely and up to the file system and the disk. Next is cluster first volume. So this volume is the actual collection of bricks. As you can see we have three bricks from different hosts. You can combine all these hosts and export them as a single volume. And ClusterFS supports multiple types of volumes called distribute or swipe or replicate. We take distribute where your data is distributed across different bricks. For example, if you have three files called file 1, file 2, file 3, and each file may go into different bricks so that you can access them easily from different hosts. Another is replicate. The replicate is more reliable, especially in case of virtualization and other use cases where you need a reliable data and you don't want to lose your data at any cost. There you can use a replicate volume where your data is replicated across bricks. The water file, you write it in a volume, is replicated across all the bricks in the volume. At least in case of replicate 3, it replicates in 3 bricks. Also you can combine them. You can make distribute replicate or distribute stripe or other cases. Like you can combine all of them. And another important aspect here is the quorum. ClusterFS supports something called quorum. So if you enable quorum, you can avoid split pane. The split pane condition is like, you have 3 bricks, assume one brick goes down or something happens, finally end up in 3 bricks having different datas. Now you don't know what is the final data or actual data. Those cases can be avoided easily by quorum. If you enable quorum, when majority of the bricks are not there, it will automatically make the file system read only and you can't write anything, so that you can safely recover from your failure. Next, this is about how you access the ClusterFS volume through queues. At least in virtualization case, you have a QEMU running your virtual machines. If you want to access an image from ClusterFS volume, it goes through kernel. From kernel, it asks the ClusterFS fuse client. That requests the cluster brick which is running on the remote ClusterFS server through net. And that again calls the underlying XFS file system. As you see from here, there are a lot of kernel switches happening from user space to kernel space. Ideally 5 switches here. This is not performing well. So what we have is, we have something called libgf API support. This helps you to communicate directly to the cluster brick and get your volume data. So with this QEMU kernel supports this libgf API. With this, the QEMU can directly talk to the ClusterFS brick and get the image or volume data, ClusterFS data. There is one bug or one RFE missing in this. Currently, QEMU supports only one host. Though ClusterFS is a clustered file system, currently QEMU talks to only one host. If that host fails, then your VMs will get passed. So we are working on this bug so that if that host fails, even QEMU should be able to talk to other hosts in the cluster to get its volume back. We are working on this patch. Okay. Next is hyperconverged. Hyperconverged OVERT setup. If you see the diagram, maybe let's compare this with the first one. Here, how many hosts you had? One is for engine, another 3 for your hypervisor, then separate storage. At least you need 5-6 hosts here. But in case of hyperconverged, you need just 3 hosts. And the same host will be used for both storage as well as virtualization. This is very useful in case of small scale deployments where you have very limited set of hardware and still you want to try out virtualization techniques. Here we run both cluster bus and KVM on same physical nodes, and for overt engine we use something called the same thing what we explained, the hosted engine. So overt engine becomes HA enabled automatically and runs inside a VM that can manage the other VMs, other hypervisors. It can also manage the cluster bus volume, and these boxes can be standardized so that you can add, you can scale out or scale up easily. You can add more storage later to the same host, or you can add bring in multiple additional host to scale out your setup. Yeah, this is overall hyperconverged over cluster setup. Next we will see, we had to do some enhancements to bring to this. The first thing was libgf API support. It was not there, now it's there. Since it's there, and replicate 3 volume. So previously, especially with over 3.5, when people tried hosted engine with the cluster, they started using replicate 2 volumes and they get into split brain situations. And split brain situations are very costly in over, because when you go to split brain situation, then your VMs are lost or at least passed. You have to reboot them, or most of the cases you have to reboot, they won't resume automatically. And sometimes if you have corrupted data, there are cases where same VM running in different hosts, there are multiple problems. As a result, they stop supporting replicate 2 volumes and start supporting ClusterFS for hosted engine. In 3.6, it was enabled with replicate 3 volume, so you mandatorily have to have replicate 3 volume to use ClusterFS in hosted engine. Now that support is there. Another thing is called overt engine appliance. Deploying a hosted engine setup is, traditionally it was very tough, because you have to solve the chicken and egg problem. You have to bootstrap your virtual machine, which is going to run the hosted engine VM, and add the hypervisor hosts. And overt had something called hosted engine deployment script. That script is a very interactive script, but it asks a lot of questions. It's all related questions. So if you make any mistakes in between, then you have to start from beginning and you have to clean up the setup. Even we face a lot of issues. But with this appliance model, what they come up with is, you have a pre-packaged VM appliance, which has OAuth already installed, you can just use them. In this model, you could avoid multiple errors in your deployment. Also, that VM can be customized using cloud init. Basically, we have to configure a few things like what should be the FQDA name for the VM, what should be the username, password, all those things you can easily configure. And one more enhancement is the SAD configuration. Previously, there are three hosts, and VM can run, hosted engine VM can run on any host, but the configuration about the hosted engine VM was stored separately in all these three hosts. So if at all you want to change any make any changes, you have to edit same config file in all the hosts to make a change to the hosted engine VM. Now that is being said, that will be stored in the same storage, the ClusterFS storage or NFS storage, whatever you use for hosted engine. In that way, the configuration will be shared across all the hosts. And we have some mechanism to upgrade from over 3.5, where the configurations are separately stored in all the hosts, to move to the SAD configuration. And we have a management GUI. So till now, if you want to change something in the over engine VM, like I want to give more memory for the hosted engine VM, or I want to change the processor, number of processor allocated, then you have to edit the config file. But now we can do this through UI. But I came to know that these features were kind of lost. In the last minute it was removed from 3.6, but it will be there in next 4.2 release. Okay, what are the main ingredients for hyperconverged? You just need 3 physical hosts with virtualization enabled. Then you need at least some 20 GB of memory, 20 GB of storage space in your system, because we are going to run cluster storage there and you are going to run your VMs there. That's very, very minimum. If at all you want to try from a virtual machines, the hyperconverged, you should need these minimum requirements. But in a, at least in a hardware, if you go to hardware, I hope you will have more capacity by default. The next important thing is you have to configure your DHCP. Basically, you have to reserve a MAC address for your hosted engine VM, and that MAC address would be resolved to a fixed IP. And you should change, you should add a configuration in DNS to give a predefined DNS name for that IP. Because you are going to communicate with the VM, the hosted engine VM, using the same FQDN always. So that we have to make these configurations. Next, you have to just install the package. And the last point is very interesting, because you need physical console access or network access, that's a standard, but why do you need screen package? It's because, since I told you, the bootstrapping the hosted engine VM is a little complex, and it involves multiple steps like configuring your firewall and configuring your network. You may end up losing your connectivity to the physical server. As a result, if at all, if you lose, you have to get back to the same session. That can be done through screen or the physical console. Next. So how do you set up? The first step to set up the hyperconverged setup is setting up your cluster volume. As I told you, we need to replicate three volumes. So we have three hypervisors. Make a cluster storage, trusted storage pool out of those three hosts. Then create a three-way replica volume at least one volume for now. Maybe later we can create another volume. The one volume will be used for hosted engine VM, which will contain the disk image for the hosted engine VM. Another volume will be used for regular VMs, which we are going to create. And as I already told you, we have to enable cluster quorum. Otherwise, you may get into split brain situations. Another important feature is sharding. This was recently introduced in cluster. So without this feature, we were facing many problems with the self-heal. When self-heal happens, it eats up the whole CPU time. And your VMs are not getting any CPU, and VMs are getting passed. As a result, either we have to restart the VMs or... Yeah, we have to restart the VM. And especially in case of hyperconverged case, even your hosted engine VM will get passed. So it's kind of difficult situation to recover from that condition. But if you enable sharding, your big files, your disk image files, which are anyway going to be big, will be striped into little different from normal striping, will be chunked into different chunks of 512. It's a configurable size. By default, we use 512 MB shard. It will be chunked into 512 MB shards and will be stored in different bricks. So that self-heal, and it greatly improves self-heal performance and as well as GROP performance. We tried with GROP as well. And it actually solves the CPU problem. Now with the self-heal, we are not seeing more CPU usage. We had to do a few more tuning, like setting the network peak timeout and self-heal algorithm, and the overt group, setting the owner ID and user ID to 3.36. Sorry, that should be GID. Okay, next thing is the hosted engine setup. As I told you, we need these three packages. One is the overt engine appliance, which brings in the OVA image or hosted engine image. Next is hosted engine setup, that brings in the hosted engine setup script, which helps you to bootstrap the VM, hosted engine VM. Next, VDSM cluster, which brings in all the VDSM packages. Then this is our friend, the hosted engine deploy. If you run this script, it's a very interactive script. It asks multiple questions, and these are the few important questions which will be asked. One is the storage type. You have to choose storage type, and you have to enter the guest surface volume name with the host. If you do that, next, it will ask you how you want to bootstrap your VM. There are three options. Either you can use OVA image, or you can use CD-ROM, or you can use Pixiboot. But as I told you, using OVA image is the easiest and better way. So you choose OVA image. Next thing, you can do some customization to the VM through CloudInit, and it supports, the script supports on-demand creation of CloudInit configuration, where you can specify the FQDN name and the root user password, etc. Also, you have to give the MAC address for the VM's NIC, which you have reserved in your configured in your DHCP server. If you want more details or exact commands, please read my blog. I have written this blog to help you with the deployment. That covers all the details, exact sequence of commands, what you have to run, what you have to answer. So once you do this, what you get is, you have hosted engine VM running. You can log into the Overt engine. You can see a cluster with one host where you run the script. So now next step is enabling cluster service. So by default, Overt engine doesn't enable cluster service for the cluster, for the cluster where it's being deployed. So we have to enable cluster service for the cluster. Next, we have to add the remaining two hosts to the setup and create another storage domain where you will create your VMs. Any questions? Yanni? Do you? You mean this ping timeout?
Yes, yes.
These are all volume configuration.
Okay.
Cluster volume options.
When you create the volume.
After creating volume, you can set these options actually. Basically, these are all volume options, enabling cluster quorum and enabling sharding. It's all cluster volume options. Yeah. So how do you enable cluster? Cluster was integrated with Overt, I think, since 3.1 for a long time. Currently, you can manage your whole cluster deployment using Overt. In this hyperconverged case, we have a cluster where you want to run both Overt and cluster. So by default, I think it should be fixed in Overt. By default, it doesn't enable cluster service. So we have to go and edit the cluster to enable cluster service. If you enable cluster service, then it automatically takes care of bootstrapping your cluster host, like managing your firewall, managing your cluster ID service. It also supports volume management. You can create your volumes, you can start, stop, or you can add bricks, rebalance. It supports almost all the cluster operations. And you can use the same REST API which is exposed by Overt to do all your volume operations. Though we enable cluster and web service for the same cluster, there is one problem with Overt, because the Overt engine doesn't consider that it's a cluster. Cluster service is running in this host when it does fencing or other power saving related operations. What happens is, if you enable power management for a host, and if that host is not reachable for some reason, it will reboot the host. It may not be required in case of cluster case, but still it will reboot because it's not considering the fact that the host is running cluster service. This has to be fixed. Next thing is adding additional host. Since we are done with the first host and we are bootstrapped the hosted engine VM, only thing remaining is adding the remaining two hosts to the cluster. Just go and add the cluster. In the add cluster, you will see a checkbox saying, do you want to make this as a hosted engine agent? Do you want to configure hosted engine agent? If you say yes, then it will configure the hosted engine agent on this host as well. But this UI was removed for some reasons in the last minute because of some bugs. So again, the host engine deploy is your friend, which can be used to add additional host. How do you go to the second host, run the same script? This time it won't ask you so much questions, only you have to give the same volume. If you do that, then it automatically takes care of most of the things. Now your second host are there. Similarly, you can add the third host. Now you have three hosts in the cluster which are running both cluster and web services. Next is creating storage from cluster. See, I already told you, OVERT supports cluster deployment and cluster management. You can create your volumes in OVERT itself, either through Web Engine portal or through REST API. It supports other cluster features like volume profiling, capacity monitoring, geo-replication, volume snapshot, almost everything, whatever is there in the cluster. Next thing is adding the storage domain using the ClusterFS volume. So now that we have created a volume, which will be used for the regular VMs, we have to create a storage domain using this ClusterFS volume. Here the important point is this one. You have to give the volume path, and you have to give the mount options with the backup Alpha server. This will be used to configure the OVERT that, so that when the main host this fails, host 1 fails, it could talk to host 2 or host 3. So this is really required. This is called, so we have developed this dashboard as a UI plugin OVERT. Actually we had a dashboard for cluster, which takes care of all cluster related entities. Now we have included virtual machine box also there, and this gives you a complete picture of what's happening in your deployment, like how you are doing with the capacity, like how much storage you have in total, how much is used or how much is free, and how you are doing with the CPU and memory utilization, that's average out of all the hosts, and how is the network traffic, and how many hosts are up, and how many is in maintenance, and how are you doing with the volume, cluster volumes. We have some different states in the cluster volumes, like volume can be up or volume can be down, that's normal. We have something called degraded. What's degraded is in a replica 2-3 volume, if one brick goes down, still your data is available, but it's kind of degraded. You are not able to access another node. You have only 2 nodes serving the data. That's degraded. We have something called partial, where in a distributed volume, if you lose one node or one brick, your data is partially available, not fully available. That's called partial. You should see those statuses when that happens. Also, virtual machines you can see here. If for some reason if your network is broken, you should see some nicks are down or something similar there. This is quite useful. So next, how do you manage your hosted engine? I think we talked about it a little bit about it. You can change your hosted engine VM configurations like memory and CPU allocation and network configurations through UI, but currently it's not supported. I think it should be in 4.0. Same, it uses the shared storage. When you change something, when the hosted engine VM restarted, it automatically picks up the new configuration and uses it. Next thing is hosted engine management. So in hosted engine, you can configure a few things like state transition, SMTP. These things are very important because your OVERT engine is a VM. What happens, for some reason the VM dies, and you may not know that VM died, VM is not running. The hosted engine VM itself is not running, which means you are not managing the whole setup. But in hosted engine, you can configure your mail address. So whenever the VM state changes, either it goes to down, from up, or up to down, or any state changes, you'll get a mail notification saying, okay, I'm dying, it's going down, it's up. In that way, you are being alerted that something wrong happens. Also, you can configure other things like timeout and the host scoring. The scoring, host score is used to define where the hosted engine VM should run. For example, you have different hosts. Among 3 hosts, 1 host is highly powerful, other 2 hosts are not, they have less CPU or less memory. Then the higher power host will get the highest score and it will run the hosted engine VM. Also, we did few enhancements recently. One is cluster forwarding, we talked about it. Another is arbiter volume. Actually, to try out this hyperconverged setup, we no need 3 volume. We no need 3 hosts. It could be done with the 2 hosts itself. But for replica 3 volume, we need 3 host. That can be easily solved by the arbiter volume, where the third brick will not be a, in case of replica 3, the third brick will be used only for metadata purpose. When you store a file in a replica 3 volume, normally it goes, it gets stored in all the 3 bricks. But in arbiter volume, only the, in third brick only metadata is stored, not the actual data. So that can be very less in capacity. The machine itself may not be as, the, need not have the same capacity as other machines. Another is replace brick. This is important because if you want to replace one node in the host engine setup, currently it's difficult. You have to do some manual steps in the cluster to replace the code. Now what we are trying is, that should be doable from the UI itself. You can automatically bring in a new host with a replacement for a old failing host. It will be done through UI, without CLI, any usage of CLI. And the backup all file support in Libert and QEMU, which we talked about. The next session will be focusing more about these talks. That's all I have today. I hope you understood something. Any questions?
What would be the performance impact of running that cluster underneath the KVM thing? So I can imagine if it's heavily used for database or something like that, doesn't it too much preempt the KVM stuff?
I think when it, cluster bus by default doesn't use much CPU, I feel. That's why I think we are running some tests. We didn't see any major performance issues with those things. The main problem was with the self-field. When self-field runs, we used to see more performance issues. But with the sharding, that is also getting reduced. We don't see any major performance bottleneck we didn't see. But still, we are in evaluation state. We are running some performance tests. Now with even with arbiter volumes.
And another question, I mean, if the host gets sensed because the manager doesn't reach 3GSM, do we use the knowledge from cluster about the other nodes to detect if it should get sensed or
no.
Just rely
no,
on...
Currently it's not there. Currently it's not there. That's why we recommend not configuring power management in case of hyperconverged. Any other questions? Thank you.
Thank you.
There is some water if you need some.